give you an example of how bad Azerbaijan were acting, a video which we included in our documentary, they videoed themselves, soldiers, finding an old man, you're talking about a 60, 70-year-old man, beheading him, cutting off his head, killing his pigs, and then balancing his head on his pigs. Like, that, to then say there was war crimes on both sides, it's like, hang on, wait, there's a bit more to that, you know what I mean? You're talking about, like, a country that were giving hero medals to soldiers that had been caught playing football with a 17-year-old Armenian Yazidi's head after beheading him.
Cool, to start off with, could you tell the camera and the audience at home your name, age, and a brief description of your job?
Sure, yeah. So my name is Jake Hanrahan, I'm 32 years old. I'm a journalist and documentary filmmaker, mostly known for covering war and conflict.
Cool, could you give us like a brief description of your history as a war reporter?
Yeah, I mean, I've been doing it for about, I reckon, like 8 years now, properly, so I started off kind of writing articles about like certain situations in war because I couldn't afford to go to war because I was a freelancer. So I was like, I was working as a labourer on a building site, I was working in a call centre, worked in a boxing gym for about 5 years, which was all good, but it's like I wanted to be a reporter. I was like, I want to be a journalist, I think I can do it. So I was just writing on the side, and eventually I got like a name for myself to the point where when Vice News started, it was normal Vice, I was writing for them a bit, but when Vice News started, I was like, right, that's everything I want to do without the stuff I don't want to do. And I basically just kind of hassled who became my boss, like emailed him, like, I need to work for you, I need to work for you. And he's like, all right, come in, give me some ideas. So I went in, and I remember he was like, oh, I forgot you were coming in, I'm going to be out for 8 hours. I was like, right, fuck, like, okay. So I was like, he said, come back another day. And I thought, nah, forget this, because firstly, the price of the ticket from the Midlands to London, I was like, I'm not paying that twice. And secondly, I was like, he's not going to bring me back in. So I waited and waited and waited. It's about 5 hours. He came back in and he was like, why are you here? And I was like, look, I want this meeting. And I think from that, he was like, oh, okay, come in, let's talk. So I pitched him some ideas. He liked it. And after about a month, like, I remember they rang me and were like, are you going to come and work for us then, sort of thing? And I was like, yeah. And they were like, what's your day rate? And I was like, I don't even know what day rate really is, you know what I mean? So I came in with some mad low day rate, which for me was really good money at the time. And I was like, wow, I can't believe they accepted that. Looking back, it's like, yeah, of course they did. But yeah, so I did that. And then I started working at Vice News. And that's where like all these ideas I'd had, like writing about war from afar, I was like, right, now I want to do it. You know, I want to go there, I want to experience it, I want to do it proper. Because I think you really have to be on the ground to understand it. So eventually, within a couple of months, they were like, look, your research is good. Do you want to do documentaries? I said, yes, that's what I'm trying to get into. And then all of a sudden, they were just like, right, off you go. And, you know, I started covering clashes, riots in Europe, that sort of thing, kind of worked my way up. Then I was in Turkey filming with Kurdish militants who were like, it was riots, it was clashes, but it was a bit more heavy. You know, they had firearms, they were shooting at the police with, you know, actual guns and that. And then it got to the point where it was like, right, okay, I think 2014 was the first time I went. I was like 24 years old and I went to Iraq. So I went to the front line there in Mosul at the time when ISIS still had it. And I was just like, wow, like it was very weird to be, I don't know, what was, everything was working up to it. And then I was there and I was like, oh, okay, like I'm here now. And actually not much was happening. Like there's a misconception with frontline work that it's constantly bang and crash. Often it's not, it's like you're waiting around, but when it does go off, obviously it's a big scene. But yeah, that's how I started. That's how I kind of went to like my first frontline, if you like. And then from then on, I guess they thought, you know, Vice, they were like, yeah, he knows what he's doing. And I just covered loads of stuff. So since then I've covered the war in Ukraine, war in Syria, been to Iraq a couple of times again, the recent Armenia war with Azerbaijan. Yeah, all over the place. Various riots, wars, clashes, that sort of thing.
That's crazy. What is the most dangerous place you've been in?
The most dangerous place I've been. It depends how you like kind of quantify like danger, I think, because people will say, oh, you went to Syria, that's mad. It's like, well, Syria is dangerous, obviously, but actually, in the Kurdish regions where I was, they've kind of got it locked down. You know what I mean? There's a big risk of car bombs. There's a big risk of like ISIS sleeper cell attacks. We went to Raqqa when it was under control of the Kurdish militias, but still there were like ISIS sleeper cells everywhere. There's basically ISIS stood there on the side of the road, ones that haven't been captured, and they're just like mean mugging you. And you're saying to the commanders, like, that's ISIS. And they're like, yeah. And it's like, it's pretty sure, you know what I mean? And they're like, look, we can't do anything until we know. Like, otherwise, then they're like, we'd be as bad as everybody else, just arresting everybody. And that's just mad. And we were working with a female fixer, like helping us translating and that. And she wasn't wearing hijab because she's Kurdish. She wasn't religious. She was like, I don't wear hijab, even though she's from Syria or whatever. And they were like spitting on the floor. Like, you could tell they were like extreme. So that was quite, I felt dodgy there. And there's like the whole city's in ruins and you're like, right, okay. But then there's the other danger of like places like Mexico, which I haven't been to. That to me would be more dangerous. Like, high possibility of kidnap. They behead journalists all the time, anywhere really. You know, if you're not in Cancun, there's a risk, I think. So that to me, I think, wow, that's really dangerous. I really respect journalists that are doing that. For me, frontline stuff, it is dangerous, but it's like once you're away from it, you're away. For me, the more scary stuff is like when there's a constant threat of maybe you're in a totalitarian country and you're kind of undercover-ish, not undercover, but you know what I mean? You're trying to stay away from them. And if you get caught, which happened to me in Turkey, I was filming with the Kurdish militias, I got caught and arrested because the Kurds were fighting against the Turkish state who don't really want them. You know, like, I saw a video last week of a lad getting arrested for singing in Kurdish in Istanbul, you know. So there's this idea that, oh no, the Kurds are our brothers, but actually the kind of state kind of, you know, attacks on them proves that that's not true. So at one point, a couple of years back, the Kurdish militias were fighting against the Turkish government. It was mad, like urban combat. I had good access with them. We kind of went there, kind of snuck into the Kurdish areas where the police couldn't even go to. And that was like, that felt really, really dodgy because you're talking about like 300 like teenagers with RPGs and like very kind of rudimentary weapons, like just basic AKs. And a few grenades fighting what is NATO's second largest army. So there was a point where one night where the military had turned off the electric for the whole town and were just firing, like the kids were saying, oh, it's a 50 cal, I don't know, but it sounded like it, like a big gun. And they're firing that, and then this one lad was like, oh, relax, like one of the militants, he's like, relax, it's harassing fire. And then we just heard like mad gunfire over our head. So he meant like they're not shooting at us, they're just shooting. And then within a second it was going over our head. So I was like, that's not harassing fire. So we had to like run through the streets, like middle of the night, like dark as anything. I was about like, I think it's about like 25, yeah. So I was really young. But you know, at the same time, it was like, I was there for a reason. I was there to do my job. It's, you don't go there to be like, oh no, uh-oh, this is scary now. You know what I mean? So you just accept it. But I would say, I think probably the worst situation was when I did get sent to prison in Turkey, just for doing my job. They said I was a terrorist. I was like, what? Like, are you mad? So they said I was a terrorist. My friend was a terrorist. Two people I was working with, like, they're terrorists. Sentenced to prison. We was there for like, not long, for like about 2 weeks, just under that. And it was weird because we was in like five different prisons and they were like max security. So we're in for terrorism. Allegedly for helping the Kurdish militias, which all we were doing was filming them, like, that's what we do, you know what I mean? I filmed with people, you know, militia forces from all over the world, and they were like, right, in prison. So we was in like jail with ISIS, like, which was really weird because they'd caught ISIS fighters as well. And then at one point we ended up in the same cell block as like these Chechen ISIS. That was just mad. I was like, right, this is bad, like, it's rubbish, like, you know what I mean? This wasn't worth it. But other than that, I would say, like, it's nowhere near as dangerous as it looks. Like, you only see, obviously, when I'm making a documentary, I'm not going to show you 2 hours of me waiting around and my mate chatting, you know what I mean? So when you see the bang, 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 that's to show this is what's happening in the war. So, you know, it is dangerous. I don't want to say it's not, but I don't want to also act like, you know, I think, you know, a soldier, for example, or a fighter, it's much more dangerous for them, you know what I mean? Or civilians just living there, you know, that's the worst part. You end up in, you know, like, especially when we was in Kurdistan, and there's areas where there's just people, like this old woman we met, she's like, oh, I lived in this house my whole life and it was rubble. because she just happened to live where the combat was happening, and her house got shot, and it got shot so bad that, you know, it destroyed the whole thing, and it was just collapsed. So it's just like that is, you know, that's brave to even be there, and very sad as well. So I think that's, you know, scariest is for the civilians, really.
Did you feel like you were going to get released when you were caught in Turkey?
No.
Nah.
Nah.
That was it?
Nah. I thought that was it, mate. So they're coming in, like, so the thing is, when we was in Turkey, we was in prison, the guards are, like, constantly fucking with you. So they come in, like, sort of saying, we can understand, but a friend of ours we were in with, he was Kurdish, but he spoke Turkish, so he could translate. And they're sort of, like, hinting, like, oh, yeah, you probably got 7 years, like, did you hear? And you're like, oh, no, like, 7 years, like, and you're talking, like, Turkish prison, like, it's not, everyone's like, you see Midnight Express? It's not Midnight Express, but it is, like, proper shit, you know what I mean? Like, it's not good, you know? There's no Xbox, you know? There's no, you know what I mean? It's worse than basic, you know what I mean? Like, it's bad in there. So, you're in all these prisons and, you know, you're just hearing mad stuff all night. Luckily, we were sectioned off because we were terrorists, we were classed as terrorists. They sectioned us off into, like, an area where you're not really in main flow with anybody else, because I don't know, you know, if you were a terrorist, you could organize or whatever. So mostly it was just 24 hours a day in the cell, but I'm with, like, you know, two of my best friends, you know, so it could have been worse. I didn't think we were going to get out for a while, like, just the way it was going, and I know what that country's like. We all know now, you know, like, journalists are getting sent to prison for absolutely nothing. I mean, there was a woman recited a poem the other day on TV, which the government decided was not a poem that she should recite, and she's been arrested and she's in prison. Like, it's just crazy. I know people that are doing 3 years for insulting the government on Twitter there. So, you know, whilst people, oh yeah, I love having good parties and that in Bodrum, like, remember there were hundreds of thousands of people, Turks, Kurds, other people, all in prison for nothing, you know, it's a totalitarian vibe. So, unfortunately, I kind of knew that it wasn't as bad back then as it is now, but I knew, like, this is bad. So I didn't think we was going to get out. I thought at least a year maybe, but then one day they were just like, right, you're out, get out. I was like, what? Like, they're like, you're out. So, all right, cool, we're going home. And then we got taken to another prison. So I was like, he was like, you're going home? I was like, when today? He was like, don't know. So I was like, right, I got put in another prison. Then we're in main flow. So basically the last prison was a deportation prison. So we're getting deported. So we had to wait 3 days. What was it for? I forget. But like a few days basically to be like, right, you're going to be processed. But whilst you're being processed, you're in this prison. And the other people getting processed were Chechen ISIS fighters who had been fighting in Syria as volunteers. They'd come across the border to get, you know, treatment in the hospital or to, you know, have a rest from the battle or whatever, because the border with Turkey and Syria was a very porous back then. You could go back and forth. And they'd been caught as well. So there, obviously, the authorities arrested them. You're going to get deported back to Chechnya or wherever. And we ended up in the same prison. So we're being processed with all these ISIS guys. I'll never forget, there was one lad who had open bullet wounds in his arm, just like pus dripping out of them, because he'd obviously been shot on the border and was just, I don't know, he was just mad. And we just sat there, like, drinking tea with them, like, in this room. Like, and the maddest thing happened with me and my friend. Unfortunately, my friend Rasul, he was left in. He was in longer than us because he's Kurdish, you know. But he got out as well, thank God. But so me and Phil are in there. And luckily, it wasn't just ISIS. There was loads of, like, refugees as well, like, who basically saved our lives. Like, really good lads. Load of Afghan refugees who, like, I owe my life to, basically. They just, like, protected us. They were like, come with us. These lot is ISIS. Come with us, like, you know. We're chill, like Muslims, but we're not extremists, don't worry. And we was like, cool, cool, cool. So they were like, come with us, sit with us. And we was watching the dead TV room there, like main flow, you've got your own kind of cell, which you can come in and out anytime. And we had the TV room, and like, we're there watching Al Jazeera. And then me and my friend came up on the telly, and like, they were like, oh, you know, Jake Hanrahan, Philip Pendlebury released from prison. And I was like, hang on, I'm in prison. Like, I'm watching this in prison. So this lad sat with us, just burst out laughing, and he was like, you're still in here, this Afghan lad, Ali. And he was like, you know, you two all right, come with us. So we went with him. He gave us like a bunk. So we slept in his room and hit with another lad, another Afghan lad, and this Iranian guy. And they were just like, look, we're going to look after you. A Palestinian lad as well, lovely lad. And that was probably the maddest 3 days of my life. Like, the maddest three. Basically, we found out afterwards that, I don't know how true it was, but I believe it. One of the Afghan lads that was in our room spoke great English. He messaged me afterwards on Skype, because, like, you weren't meant to, but we slipped contact details, put him in our shoes. And he was like, oh, by the way, you know when there was that big argument in our hallway? I said, yeah, what was that about? Why were they kept coming to you? He's like, well, they wanted to lure you into the bathroom, and, like, there was, like, you know, communal showers. He's like, oh, they wanted to slit your throat, because obviously we were, like, you know, kafir or whatever, like, we were their number one enemy. And he was like, oh, I was, you know, telling them, if you do that, I'm going to, like, you know, do whatever, tell the guards or whatever. And I was like, oh. I was like, what? And he's like, I didn't tell you because I knew you'd be worried. And I was like, yeah, like, you know what I mean? There's one day where I knew something was wrong, because they had, like, Ali, the lad I said, he'd come in with a lighter, and he'd made a knife out of a lighter. So we got a teaspoon, he'd sharpened the handle, and then, like, melted the lighter and, like, stuck the kind of teaspoon in the lighter. So we had, like, this makeshift, like, shank in the room, and he was like, don't worry. And I was like, oh, fuck. I was like, why are you telling me don't worry? Like, you know what I mean? Like, there's obviously some problem. But yeah, like, basically these, like, legend, like, Afghan refugees and this Palestinian lad just basically saved us. And then one day they come in, like, right, you're gone, armed guard all the way to the airport, and they put us on a plane. Within, like, that same day, we went from being in jail, and then I remember me and my mate went out to Brick Lane and got a haircut, and I was like, mad. I was like, ain't this mad, like, the maddest experience. And I was 25 years old, so yeah, sorry, that's a long way to explain it, but that was such a mad experience, you know.
What was it like growing up? Like, do you feel your upbringing had, like, sort of impact on your career choices?
Yeah, I didn't really grow up maybe how many reporters do. Not to say that there's anything wrong with going to private school or anything like that, but we do have a disproportionate amount of British reporters in the industry that are successful, that all went to private school, went to top universities, their parents could pay for them, and that's all fine. I've got nothing against people. Like, obviously, it is what it is, you know, that's great. Their parents did well, so they could do well. But there is a problem where that doesn't really then represent Britain properly. You know, I'll be honest with you, within journalism, British journalism, there's, despite them acting woke and all progressive, there's a very kind of snotty, snobbish reaction to, like, working class people within journalism, particularly, like, legacy reporting, like, big places. And they see you as either, like, they see working class people as either, right, we're going to fit an ethnicity kind of quota, which is very messed up in my opinion. It's like, why is it you're putting them on camera, but why aren't they at the top positions? Top positions is all the same old white lads from Eton or whatever, much like our government. And it's like, why is that? You know what I mean? So I feel like they either use people for, like, a quota, or they use them as, like, an oddity. You know what I mean? Which, I don't know, it really, that I think is a bit of an issue within reporting. But anyway, so yeah, I didn't go private school, and I'm from the East Midlands, just a very dead little town in the North Ants. It's not particularly, it's just dead, it's just horrible, it's just like, it's just proper run down. It's one of them places that you would never need to go there. There's no industry. People either become, like, a drug dealer, work in a factory, or they kind of leave these days. The council, due to the government, ended up turning all the kind of youth spaces into, like storage lockers and stuff like that. So everything is dead. It's quite a violent place in terms of, like, just constant violence, but it's not like gang warfare or anything like that. It's just like a very weird, violent, kind of boring place. It's very mundane, like, and it's just like very, a lot of heroin problems, a lot of that. They're really nice areas as well. That's the thing. It's a weird kind of bipolar region, the North Ants, where you can drive to one part and it's like, wow, it's beautiful countryside. And within 10 minutes, you know, it's a joke. You're like, where are we? Like, you know, like, it's just absolutely dead. So I grew up around that kind of, you know, that kind of area. You know, as a kid, I remember we lived in a hostel for a bit, lived in council estates for a bit, lived in, you know, rented housing all over the place. And I think that gave me, like, it gave me experience on just how to, like, interact with all different types of people. Because I hate snobbery and I hate, like, elitism. And I just think I learned that maybe from the way I grew up. And it's like, if I go and meet someone on the front line somewhere, wherever, I don't feel like I've ever alienated anybody. But then I have seen, like, other reporters turning up, you know, posh as fuck, camera the size of a bus. And you can just tell everyone there is just like, what? Like, they're not really, they feel like they're being put on a stage, whereas I want to capture what's real, what's actually happening. So that's why I think with my reporting, that not that like awesome, I certainly wasn't Oliver Twist or anything like that, you know, but it wasn't that easy growing up, you know, especially as a kid. So I feel like that gave me a positive experience in a way now, where I feel like I can just interact with anybody, you know what I'm saying? Like, I don't find it difficult, and I'm very happy to get, like, you know, kind of get my hands dirty, get stuck in. That's why I think I've had a lot of success embedding with, like, guerrilla forces, militias, paramilitary groups. I've had things where I've kind of turned up, I'm like, right, and they're like, who are you? I'm like, oh, I'm the reporter. And they're a bit like, you're the reporter. Like, I'm like, yeah, yeah. And they're like, all right, fuck it. Like, you know, come on, let's go. And, you know, there's a lot of young lads, a lot in wars, people, you know, often forget. The people that end up fighting the wars 99% of the time are young men. In the Kurds case, there's young women as well, but mostly young men end up fighting these wars. And I feel like I understand what it's like to be, you know, a kind of bit of a kind of bitter, disgruntled young man on some degree. And then imagine how these lads feel. They're from often poor backgrounds and there's a war on their doorstep. Now, I can't even begin to, like, understand what they're going through, but I think there is, you can find a common ground that way and be like, right, yeah, like, you know, often as well, they don't really want to talk about politics all the time. Like, there's a way to make a rapport with people like that by showing them, like, hey, like, I get it, you actually don't want to be doing this, but you have to a lot of the time. And mostly they want to talk about, like, women and football. And I think that has been a weird thing where I've just realised, I've noticed that in my work, you know what I mean? And that's helped me get access to things that people are like, how do you get access to that? I was like, there's no trick, it was just being, well, normal, like, and not being like some, like, bigwig coming in, because I think that just pisses people off. Especially, like, militias, like, people with guns and that, they recognise bullshit so quick. And if they don't like it, you know, that's that.
Have you ever witnessed any war crimes
first time? I have. War crimes. I think war crimes is very... It's hard to explain, like, obviously there is, like, crimes against humanity and everything like that, but the idea of, like, well, this is the Geneva Convention, so therefore this must be followed. Yes, it's good to follow a set of rules in war, of course, but it's like, at the end of the day, no one on the battlefield is thinking, wait, what about the Geneva Convention, you know? A lot of the time it's kill or be killed and whatever. So, you know, it depends... I think you have to look at it like that and have to be like, right, is this like, there's a very kind of privileged white Western perspective. Oh, we're so safe here in Western Europe and what they did was barbaric and blah, blah. And that is, I think you have to be careful with that, because it's like, have you been to war? Have they been in war? Have they seen families get killed? Probably not. So you have to sometimes understand. But then there is obviously jumps where it's just like, no, that is out and out objectively barbaric. You know, like ISIS, what the Azerbaijanis did to a lot of the Armenians in the recent war, cutting off heads, killing old people, you know, playing football with heads, like, just disgusting stuff. I've been quite lucky, I've not witnessed anything like that. I don't really think reporters do get to witness war crimes in that sense often, not these days, because from every military to militia, people are very aware of social media and cameras everywhere with your phone and whatever, so you don't see it like that. But I have seen, one of the things I did see in Southeast Turkey, which was evidence in my opinion of a war crime perhaps, was a 13-year-old girl was, like, we were in the area where the Kurds were under control and the young teenage lads, like militia, patrolling the area, and this young girl comes out and she's got, like, bandage on her neck and bandage on her back, and the cousin comes over and she's like, you have to film this. And I was like, no, I don't want to film this, this is like a young girl. I was a bit green, maybe I think you should film that, it's grim, but you have to shock people. But I was like, this is a young girl. And she's like, look, I'm her cousin, I look after her parents are not here, I think her parents were dead. So she was like, I'm her guardian, if you like. She's like, I am giving you permission, you can film this. I said, all right. Anyway, so she starts pulling off the bandage. I said, no, don't pull off the bandage. She won't listen, she pulled off the bandage. And this girl had, like, just this like, kind of pus-filled, like, hole in her neck. And then the same in her back. And basically what had happened was a bit of shrapnel had hit her in the back and a bullet had hit her in the neck from the military firing into the town. And I witnessed the military firing blind into the town. So I don't want to say it's a fact that that happened, but I don't think it's, you know, out of the bounds of possibility to think that that happened. And this young girl, and I was like, look, she needs to go to a hospital. And she's like, look, we've tried to take her to the hospital, but there are tanks parked outside the hospital, which there were, and we'd seen them. And every time we go down there, they say, if you bring her in, we'll arrest you for being terrorists. And the girl was like, look, we're just civilians, we live here. And I was like, what can you do? And she was like, we're just treating her the best we can. And I was like, Jesus Christ, like, that's grim, man. Like, you know, that's a war crime. And you're talking NATO there, everybody in the West, oh, NATO is so great. You know, a lot of our NATO allies commit war crimes often and are never investigated because NATO is so great, allegedly. But not to say there's any other different with Russia and everything. They're all the same, in my opinion. But yeah, it's one of them ones where that is... it's not like witnessing the war crime like firsthand, you know. I didn't see a kid get shot or anything like that, but it's like, that's dark, you know, that's harsh to see. And it's that always stayed with me. Like, I've seen a lot of like bad stuff, seen bodies in a pit in Ukraine and stuff like that, but that's not direct, like a kid, you know. A kid is just always innocent in a war, you know. A kid can only be innocent, you know. And she certainly wasn't a fighter by any means. And the fact that she couldn't even go to the hospital because her family, the only person she really had left, would be arrested as a terrorist. Like, I don't know, that's dark, you know. I think that's really bad. Stuff like that. So that is bad. That's a war crime, I think you could definitely say that. Or at least if NATO, which they don't, but if someone responsible did investigate it, I'm sure they would find evidence of war crimes. That being said, within that war I'm on about, there was a big investigation from another, I think from something within the UNHCR or the EU or something. And there was another war crime committed there where the military burned, I think about like 50 people hiding in a basement as a bomb shelter, and the military just threw petrol in there and set them all alight and burned them alive. So that happened, I think I was in prison when that happened at that point. So yeah, that was a war full of war crimes. I've seen a lot of stuff where you're like, stuff where they're firing and you're thinking, they don't know what's over there, they probably shouldn't be firing like that. But it's very easy for me to say, I nip in and out, I go to the front line, I document what happens. Yeah, there's danger for me, I put my head down and that. These lads are fighting there every single day, you know, especially in Ukraine, I've seen a lot of that. Talking about lads that are living in a trench for 8 years now nearly, and all of a sudden the news is interested again because of Russia, but actually they've been fighting this war for 8 years. So there is that. It's like, it's very easy to say war crime, but you know, they're all, when it is like, obviously if it's war crime, it's bad. I guess I'm saying there's different levels to it, you know what I mean?
Yeah, I was watching your interview on the 098 before.
Fucking hell, yeah.
Yeah, I know.
Nutters, yeah.
Could you explain like who they are and like what you discovered like whilst you were
in? Yeah, so, oh man, asking about 098, I'm going to sound like a nutcase now. So, as well as doing work, war and reporting, I often, war and conflict, so let's start again. as well as covering war and conflict, I cover like extremist politics as well, because obviously a lot of extremists within politics become terrorists, become, you know, militants, whatever. It kind of goes hand in hand. So a few years back, I was looking into a neo-Nazi group called Atomwaffen Division, essentially like a neo-Nazi paramilitary group in America. They killed, I think, like 4 or 5 people in total. Where did that 098 come in? Yeah. So I was looking at them, and then all of a sudden I started seeing this weird like satanic iconography come into their like designs. And I recognised some of it because outside of my work, I'm fascinated with like weird like occult stuff. Not that I practice it or anything like that. I just find it interesting, you know, like cults and like weird kind of devil worship type stuff. Like, you know, all the like cheerful stuff, you know what I mean? So I was looking into it, and then I was like, hang on, I know that symbol. And basically, long story short, a satanic kind of occult group that started in England and believes in like human sacrifices had made its way somehow through the internet to a neo-Nazi group in America who took on their iconography and were like, right, we're like the paramilitary kind of neo-Nazi 098 force. 098 is Order of Nine Angles, it's weird. And this isn't like, you know, there's, you get all these satanic idiots. Every third podcast in Britain is, have you heard about this satanic paedophile ring? And 9 times out of 10, it's unfortunately masking a very real issue, but blowing it out of proportion with nonsense conspiracy stuff. But this was real. Like, this is, Order of Nine Angles is like actually linked to murders, 2 human sacrifices in Russia last year, actually. So this is a real group. And I was like, wow, that's fascinating. And this Nazi group kind of took on 098 iconography. And some of them even kind of became more interested in the 098 than the Nazi stuff. And yeah, it's just this, the founder of it was, he was a former neo-Nazi terrorist, then he converted to Islam and became an Islamist, like an extremist. He wrote a whole book about how great like Al-Qaeda is, like, yeah, Osama bin Laden's cool, you know, like he was really on it. Then he kind of stopped that and went into this weird like spiritual stuff. He's the guy that's behind it. He claims he's not. It's him. Everybody knows it's him. And yeah, like he was linked to like the Brixton nail bombings. He's just a very weird guy, and now it's actually spreading. And there's kids as young as 13 and 14 have been convicted in Britain as being members of the O9A, or at least, well, they're not a prescribed organisation, so they're not convicted of being that, but they're convicted of the stuff that they've been involved with as a part of the O9A. And one of the darkest things is they get like girls, like young girls, to harm themselves, like self-harm, and they take images of it. And they're basically, their thing is, whatever is depraved, whatever is seen as fucked up by society, if we can indulge in that, we become like almost like not human anymore. Not physically, there's no physical change, but they become like desensitized to the point where they're like, right, we're just devil, evil, kind of, but like really evil, you know. It's a weird concept. It sounds like a conspiracy. It sounds like a nutcase, but it's real, you know. The fact that, to give you an idea of how real it is, the government right now in Britain is considering prescribing the O9A as a terror organisation. So they know it's real. There's been several attacks related to them. And yeah, it's just like, it's a rabbit hole, you know. It's the maddest rabbit hole I've ever been into. I'm fascinated by it, you know. Really fascinated by it. And then the thing is as well, they've got like thousands and thousands of pages of like books, like lore, like, you know, rituals. They have this mental game. It's like chess, but it's got like five different layers. It's called like the Stargate. Like, it's not just some idiot has just spawned it on TikTok, you know. It's actually like loads and loads has gone into it, which is alluring for some people. For me, I'm like, that, like, it's mad, but it's mad. Yeah, it's mad. People love it though.
Have you found anything in common, like, against all like the extremist groups that you've talked to and
like within each group?
Is there anything in common between them all?
I think that's a great question, because there's this really, not to excuse me, either, like Nazism, I absolutely hate them. I think a militant Nazi, you know, a violent Nazi, I think should be dealt with violently personally. But that is neither here nor there. But in terms of before it gets to that level, I think there's a lot that can be done. So I think if you're talking about extremism, whether it's jihadism, neo-Nazism, I don't know, whatever else there is out there, there seems to be this common thread of like mostly young men that have felt alienated within their community for whatever reason. And they all want something bigger than themselves. They want something bigger than that's what's offered to them. A lot of them have this weird kind of rose-tinted kind of idea of history. Oh, if only I was born here, I'd be a barbarian. It's like, you wouldn't, mate. You better be caved in. Like, you spend all day on the internet. But they still create that vision in their mind, you know. And a lot of it, I think, the West especially doesn't want to really accept it. But the way we're living now here, in my opinion, it's not really right, is it? You're talking dating apps. You're talking like Love Island is successful. Like, you're talking, to me, that is just like, what? Like, what's going on? Not that there's anything wrong with that, but the fact it's, you know, our government is laughing in our faces right now, stepping all over us. You've got the police crime sentencing in courts bill is probably going to be made into law. One of the most authoritarian things that has ever happened in Britain. And all people want to do is kind of scroll TikTok, you know. And that to me is terrifying, you know. I think like it's mad. So there's definitely, I understand this disconnect where people see the way things are and go, this is insane, why isn't everybody out on the streets? I mean, look right now, we've got this Boris Johnson situation. Oh, he's been having parties while people have been locked down to the point where some people won't even go and see their grandparents. There's not been one single protest in this country where people have come out and gone, right, this is wrong, enough. Everyone is completely pacified. All people want to do is social media, scroll the pain away. So my point is, these extremists, they see the same kind of thing. Yeah. But instead of them being like, right, okay, like, what can we do to help? Or I just kind of think, right, live my own life, look after my people, and that's good. They kind of think this system needs to be burned to death. We need to kill them for this reason, for this reason, for this reason. Not to give any excuse to them, but it doesn't come out of nowhere. They don't wake up one day and go, you know what, ISIS. You know what I mean? Like, they don't do that. It comes from somewhere. And then they see, like, right, I can be a hero in that life. In this life, I'm, you know, breaking my neck, working 80 hours a week in a warehouse to barely pay rent, to barely eat, to have no life, really. And I'm told that even though I'm doing that, I'm privileged, and that I'm this, and I'm that, and that, oh, don't say this, don't say that, by some rich fucker on Twitter. You know what I mean? So there is a very big disconnect where people go, right, okay, I'll just leave here and I'll go there. Whether it's fucking fascists leaving to go to Europe to join Azov battalion in Ukraine, or do some horrible, like, you know, lone soldier, lone wolf, you know, terrorism, or whether it's a Muslim lad that has become turned extremist and went to Syria, of which there were hundreds leaving Britain to do. You know, it doesn't come from nowhere, and it's not to excuse it at all. I mean, I've been on front lines, I've seen what ISIS does to a community, and I've seen as well what these horrible Nazis do to a community as well. But to stop it, you can't just be like, well, prison sentence. You have to nip it in the bud before it gets to that point. Because if someone is ending up in jail, they're this close from killing someone, or they have. So, you know what I mean? I mean, if only they could have stopped Anders Breivik, for example, before he killed however many people he killed in Norway. He was a strange case because he was a real lone wolf. But you know what I'm saying? It's like, I think people need to really look out for why this is happening. And I guess that is, to answer your question, the point I'm making is I see the same thing that joins a lot of them is just the hatred and a mission to be something bigger than what they are, and just the disillusionment with what they grew up in. Now, that's from the Western side. I couldn't tell you why it happens elsewhere. I think, to be honest, a lot of the time, like in Syria, for example, I interviewed a lad, he was a prisoner, but I interviewed him. He joined ISIS because his brother turned up and was like, right, I'm in ISIS. He was fully involved. He turned up at this lad's farm and he was like, if you don't join us, we'll just kill your wife. And he was like, right, off I go. You know what I mean? So there was that over there, it's a lot different. That's why the volunteers, the ones that leave the West or wherever and go to join, are just seen as the biggest scumbags. It's like, you chose to hurt them people. You know what I mean? Where everybody has a choice, but that, I don't know, they got on a plane to do it. You know what I mean? It's really bad, I think.
Have you ever personally had a near-death experience whilst reporting?
Near-death experience. I think it depends what you would class as near-death experience. I've had a bullet like whiz past my head. I think anyone that has covered war close up has, like any war reporter. That's
have
not.
Have you ever got injured then?
One time I was shadow boxing in front of my mate's face when he was on the phone to a producer we didn't like, and I accidentally hit the door and cut my knuckle so bad that I had to get stitches in Moldova. So that was an injury, but not a serious one. But I do have like a very big problem with my left ear. Can't really hear out of it very well.
Really?
Yeah, that was because, so I was in Turkey and they have like, the police have like sound grenades. So they threw this like sound grenade thing, and it was me being young and stupid and just too full of beans at the time. I was kind of running towards where the firing was come from. Not directly into it, but you know, I wanted a closer shot, and it just rolled to my foot. And I remember looking and I turned my head and it's like the whole thing. So my ear was never right since then. And I got back to England. Doctor said, your eardrum's knackered basically. Yeah.
Really?
Really annoying, because now I have to watch like Netflix with subtitles. Like, even if it's English, I'm like, what? Like, and everyone's like, what's wrong with you? I'm like, can't hear. But it's nothing really. I know a lad, one of my favourite filmmakers, he literally got hit with like a roadside bomb, and like, he's just full of shrapnel now, you know what I mean? So I've been very lucky, yeah.
Wow, that's mad.
Yeah, yeah, it is, yeah.
Has the spread of 3D printed weaponry sort of accelerated over time then?
Yeah, because of my doc. Nah, I wouldn't say that. I mean, so you're on about plastic defense, the doc I made Popular Front. Yeah, so I think, so I made a documentary about these 3D printed guns. The guy that made them, a guy that was having them in Europe, J-Star, God rest his soul, he died. But yeah, he was this kind of pioneer of 3D printed untraceable secret firearms in Europe. It took me 3 years to get the access, but eventually he agreed. We went out there with my platform, Popular Front, and we filmed a documentary. It's got about like 2.5 million views now, like with no advertising, so it's, you know, done really well. People loved it. And the one thing that a lot of people were, his reason was like, right, we need 3D printed guns because there are countries where the governments are despotic and the people don't have guns. How can you fight your government if they go totalitarian without firearms? They have firearms, we should have firearms. That's his argument, you know. And some of it I disagree with, some of it I do agree with, but whatever, it is what it is. So when it came out, a lot of people were like, oh, you're so bad for putting that out, Jake. Firstly, it's like, I don't care, like, this is reporting. I'm not responsible for, you know, if you're worried about what might happen as the event of the report, and you would never do anything, you know what I mean? But anyway, I was like, right, shut up, don't care. But they were like, you're irresponsible. After this doc, Europe's gonna see, you know, school shootings with 3D guns, and it's like, obviously that's not gonna happen. But the interesting part was what actually happened was what Jay Stark, the guy that came up with these guns, what he wanted to happen with his guns happened. So right now in Myanmar or Burma, a country that has a military junta, the military took over and had just been murdering people in the streets. It's horrific. If you say anything against them, you get arrested. You know, if you try and... People were trying to protest peacefully and they just started shooting people dead in the street. So now there's a load of rebels who went up into the mountains, went up into the hills, and they made these 3D printed guns because they didn't have access to guns. Some of them do have real proper guns, but there was a small group that just didn't have any, couldn't get to them. So they made 3D printed guns and are now fighting against the military junta, the people for a free country with this gun. So the irony is, what he wanted to happen and what everyone was like, that won't happen, that's an excuse, is the actually only real world effect we've seen of the 3D printed gun. So I think if, you know, at the end of the day, violence isn't good, but there will always be violence. World peace will never happen. And it's like, if there's an authoritarian whatever leaning on somebody and their way to get out of it has to be firearms, it has to be violence. I mean, that's the way it is. That's why, you know, people forget about our own history in the West, you know what I mean? That's what the West is built on. So a lot of people will have to, you know, fight back against it as well. So there's definitely been more have gone out there. In Sweden, I know they're arresting people all the time. It's like gangsters make them now. As like, it's like a trend, it's trendy to have. Oh, I've got FGC9. Yeah. They don't even use it, but they have it. Yeah, so about 100 like gangsters have bought it and are making them. But mostly, yeah, it's the lads in Myanmar. Yeah, it's mad. Yeah,
that's crazy.
Yeah, it's really mad, yeah.
Do you think, does music still have a place in war-torn countries? Is there any experiences you have from seeing grime on the front line or anything like that?
Yeah. Big time. So there's a really fascinating thing where like music plays a part in every conflict in a way. I mean, you just look back in history, look at Ireland, look at the IRA, they've got like, they call them rebel tunes, you know, rebel songs, just incredible music, all about the war, about the conflict. Every country has that, I've found, you know. Serbia had theirs, you know, Kosovo, they had theirs. And in wars I've been to, even the teenage kind of rebels in Turkey, the Kurds there, they have their own like song for their militia, you know what I mean? It's banging as well, it's really good. So, and then all of their militant groups all have their own music. Even jihadist factions have their own nasheed, you know, you can identify a jihadi group from the nasheed they're playing. ISIS had their own, which unfortunately it was a banger, you know what I mean? Like, it was, you know, and then there's Hayat Tahrir al-Sham. They have a good one as well, you know, nasheed. So music plays a massive part in any war I've ever covered. There's a really interesting story, which I didn't get a chance to go, but in Libya, a lot of like the Libyan kind of like hood kids became rebels, you know, they became militants, and they've got like all out like rap songs about the battle, you know, but it's not like, oh, I'm a big man. It's not like drill where it's like killing people for nothing. You're talking about like actual militant factions rapping about going to this neighborhood to free it from this faction. It's just like the maddest thing. So yeah, it's everywhere. Every militant group, even armies have like, I've been with the Ukrainian army and they have like their own version for their unit of like a song they sing, you know, it's mad.
Oh,
it's really cool. It's really, really cool. Yeah, it's like, it's just, yeah. And some of the songs as well that come out are like genuinely just amazing. You know what I mean? Like, yeah. Really good, yeah.
Out of all like the interviews you've conducted, is there any that hit proper hard?
Yeah. So one of the hardest ones I ever did, I was interviewing the mother of a young lad called Umit Kurt. So he was a young Kurdish boy in southeast Turkey. It was before the war really started again in that area, this one I've been talking about. It was when the kind of, a few kids were getting shot by the police, a few kids had been killed. So then a lot of the Kurdish lads came out onto the street with machine guns and were like, right, we're going to protect our area because the police keep coming in and shooting us. So, you know, the police would kind of see them and kind of think, right, maybe I won't drive down that road, whatever. So it was working for a little bit. And then one day, there was a young lad, Umit Kurt, was on this street where the militias, the militants were guarding. They were doing checkpoints, so everyone would come in, they'd say, right, give us your license, let us have a look, make sure you're not an agent sneaking in to do some damage or whatever, or a police. And he was he was a painter and decorator. He was 14, if I remember right. And he just come out of his job, or was he 15? I can't remember. Anyway, he just come out of his job, and something happened, and the police started firing into the neighborhood, and he got shot and killed. And I went and interviewed he was like, I think, the fourth kid to have been killed within like a month there, you know, all unarmed. He was a civilian, and he didn't have a weapon or anything like that. And I went and interviewed his mum, I think like a week after she'd buried him. And we sat on his bed, I didn't even realise at the time, and we sat on his bed, like kind of a settee where they slept. They're a very poor family, so they were all sleeping in the same kind of room sort of thing. And we slept on this bed, sat on this bed where he'd slept, and he had like a little teddy there. And she was holding the teddy, and she was holding a picture of him, and like just interviewing this mother, like her kid is dead, like just shot. And she, you know, when you just tell, like it was like the love of her life, you know, like her boy, her youngest boy. And yeah, that was probably the hardest thing. That was like really awful. And she broke down crying. And I did just sort of think like, why am I doing this? Like, why am I interviewing this woman? But you know, when the doc came out, a lot of Kurdish friends and a lot of Kurdish people were like, you had to do like, thanks for doing that. Because to hear in the news, kid gets shot, dead, sounds bad, whatever. You don't think about it. When you see the devastation that has left on a family, that is important. Then people go, ah, I understand now. You know, some people might say, oh, it's really gratuitous to do that. I don't think so. I think it's the opposite. I think it's the rawest, most important thing you can do is show the reality of violence, like political violence, is mothers with broken hearts. You know, it is like head sprayed out all on a wall. And you might say, oh, that's really crass. No, because, you know, when all these politicians are voting for wars and that, it's like, oh, do you know what that looks like? You know, and I think you have to. There's a great war photographer, Don McCullin. I can't remember the exact quote, but I think he said, like, he said, people should be shocked while they're eating their cornflakes on a Sunday, if you know what I mean. It's like, if you live in a safe area and your life is relatively safe, the very least you can do is be aware of what people are going through in areas that aren't safe. And you have to remember, a lot of the reasons these conflicts are ongoing are because of things people in safe areas did, you know, colonialism, whatever. It doesn't all come from nowhere. Not that that's the only reason, you know, people do have their own agency. But yeah, I just think it's important to show that. But that was definitely a very hard interview. And another one, I was in Syria like 2 years ago, and we interviewed a woman who, so she was an Arab, from an Arab area, but she joined the Kurdish female forces. The YPJ, they have like a whole female militia. And anyway, so she lived in a village, you know, she's Muslim, normal Muslim, chill, whatever. Then ISIS come to the village when they're taken over Syria. And they're like, right, you have to wear head to toe niqab. You know, you're not allowed, whatever. So she's like, right, best just do as we're told, because they were just murdering people's fathers and brothers in the street if they didn't. So she's wearing, you know, head to toe niqab. And then she was like, she liked fashion. So even with all this ISIS stuff, she's like, you know what, I'll wear my nice belt under it. You know, they probably won't see it. And I don't know what happened. Maybe it come untucked, but she's at the market and she was telling us that they saw the belt, and I think it had like studs on it or whatever. So they like arrested her for wearing a studded belt. So they arrest her, and she said they took her in. Actually, the darkest part of this was her brother joined ISIS. And I think he made sure that she stayed in prison, if I remember right. Yeah, I have to check the footage. But anyway, so she gets arrested, she gets put into prison. And the punishment is to be whipped on her back with, like, you know, I can't remember how many times, but she said it was just unbelievably brutal, like just whipped and whipped till she's bleeding, like her whole back's welted, you know, she's scarred for life. And then just for wearing a belt. And that was like really hard to listen to. It was really dark. And eventually they released her. If I remember right, she did something else. I think she wore like a bracelet and got whipped for that again. Anyway, that was hard, but then the amazing kind of arc to the story was that she said when the Kurdish forces, she was there, she's hearing all this fighting, and she said she kind of comes out of the basement, you know, as a bombshell or whatever, and she sees like female fighters, like women with like long hair, like braided and whatever, and she's like, what? Like, oh, like the Kurds are here. And she said they liberated the area, And she just went, they were like, right, we're going to look after you now, you can go wherever you want, whatever, all weekend. And she was like, no, I'm joining. And she just joined straight away. So she joined the militia, the female militia. She was like, look, these lot whipped me. And they said, okay, well, you have to take a code name. That's how like everybody does in their thing. And she's Arab, but she said, I'm taking the code name Kurdistan. And they were like, no, you know, you don't have to do that. Like, and she was like, no, like, I am, because you lot have like, you know, freed me. And I was like, wow, what an amazing story. And then I was like, well, what happened? You know, our brother's ISIS. I was like, what happened if you see your brother? She goes, I'll kill him without any question. And I was like, good. You know what I mean? Like, and that's like a very like heavy like interview. But like, you know, when you realize like, wow, like my life is just chill compared. You know what I mean? Like this is what annoys me. You see a lot of this moaning about politics and this, that and the other. And I just think some of you like over here in the West, like just have got no idea what's happening. You know what I mean? So good interviews like that. It's good to get the story out there. It's good for everybody to see it. But obviously for me, I do take that to heart. And I'm like, right, yeah, like that's a good, it's a grounding thing. You know what I mean? Humility, you know, so yeah.
Is there any training that you have to go through to be able to report on the full line? Or do they sort of let you
Yeah. So training wise, I mean, I didn't do uni. I did nothing like that. I dropped out of school when I was 16. But I just sort of taught myself the basics of journalism. But if you're talking about like practical training, there's what's called a hostile environment course. I would suggest no one go into war reporting because it doesn't pay enough, you might die. And you know, people don't really care that much about your work. You know, your story will always get, you know, will always get scrapped for like some celebrity did something, but it doesn't matter, whatever. But yeah, if you are doing it, you have to do a hostile environment training course. You don't have to, but it's good. You know, you learn like basic first aid. You learn how to put like a tourniquet on. There was a famous journalist, Tim Hetherington, and he died in Libya and he was hit with a bit of shrapnel in his leg. Nobody can say, but if someone had a tourniquet and put it on properly, he might have lived, you know? So things like that you really need to know because you might be able to save someone's life or your own life. And there's also things that I learned. We had a particularly good one. But this guy was teaching us things like certain things not to say in a different country, things that might get you in trouble. But the best training for me has been listening to other reporters. When I was younger, I was nuts. I was like, I'm going here to any front line, like da-da-da-da-da. And a lot of older war reporters were like, look, you're good, we get what you're doing, but calm down. And I was in my head, I was like, fuck that, no. But they were right. And when I have calmed down and listened and took more on board, that was a training in itself, you know what I'm saying? So I feel like I just was like, right, that made sense. But yeah, hostile environment training is important because you might see someone injured and it might be up to you to help them, your colleague or someone there, you know, no matter what, there's this idea that reporters shouldn't get involved. You're human. If someone is hurt, someone is dying and bleeding out and you're the one with the tourniquet, you help them no matter what, you know, if you're a human being and not a psycho. But, you know, I think that's important to do. Other than that, I don't really know what else you could do. I think one training, what I haven't done, but you know, people could do, is learning another language.
Yeah.
That's really important. You know, if you can learn Arabic, if you're going to the Middle East, or like Russian, you know, or Spanish even, you know, like a widely spoke language, that would be good. Yeah.
So I'm guessing you wouldn't recommend anyone to go down a similar career path.
Nah, don't do it. Do you know what it is? Yeah, it's like, if you're going to do it, you're going to do it. I can say, don't do it, don't become a war reporter. I hate that term, war reporter, but you know what I mean? Don't cover war and conflict. But if you're going to do it, you're going to do it. There's people like me, people I know that it's just, they need to do it. That's it. They're going to do it. But I would advise, I don't know, it's just, like I say, it's very selfish to your family. Whilst the work is not a selfish endeavor, you know, you're going to war to report on people's plight. That's a good thing to do, I think. You're not a hero or anything like that. Some reporters seem to think they're heroes, you're not. But it's a good thing to do, in my opinion. I feel like I get some, you know, some self-worth from it as well as putting the info out there. But, you know, it's selfish in a way to your family because you might die at any moment. It doesn't pay enough, you know, for what you're doing. It's just crazy. Like, that's why I kind of started my own platform, you know, like Popular Front. I was like, this ain't right. Like, it's just not right money. Like, this is just insane. And it doesn't pay enough, and you don't really get the respect in journalism. Like, if you're a political reporter, you're getting asked here, there, and everywhere. You're constantly, wow, have you seen their piece? Like, which I'm like, what? Like, people are dying somewhere. That to me is like, that's really important. Shouldn't we all be focused on that? You know, like, but I don't know. It's just weird. I guess people don't want to hear about war and conflict that often, but there are people that do. But if you are going to do it, you'll do it your own way and you'll make it no matter what I say. But I do tell everybody, don't do it. Yeah.
What made you make the transition between working for Vice and to starting your own platform, Popular Front?
Get me in trouble. I was at Vice News, had the best years of my entire life, met the best people ever, 4 years of my life that I would not change ever. I owe a lot to Vice, especially to Kevin Sutcliffe, who was my boss. Just like changed my life, literally changed the whole trajectory of my life. But HBO bought it out at one point, and I just started, it went from like Vice, kind of, you know, bit punk, bit kind of cutting edge, to being very corporate, which is fine for most people. For me, I don't like doing things like that. I got to a point where I got back from Ukraine, we got shelled quite heavily, so we were in like a trench, like just sitting there hoping a mortar round didn't hit us, like getting shelled very close. Great footage, whatever, showing the reality of the war. And then we got back to the UK office, and some American in the American office, this new hire with the HBO money, was telling me this, that, and the third about this edit. It's like, hang on, mate, I've got fresh dirt in my hood from getting shelled. Like, I'm not having this Yank tell me this. No offense to Americans, but you know what I mean? It's like, I'm not having it, you know? So, and it used to be where you could kind of be like, no, that's not right. And Vice News would be like, yeah, got it. You know, you're involved, very big team effort. And it became a thing where you're the reporter, you go out, we're taking that from you, and now we're going to build it how we want to build it and then put it out. And it's like, hang on, I'm why have I been removed from the equation? You know, and I didn't like that feeling at all. I like to have control over my stories, because I did feel that sometimes, not that there was an agenda being pushed, but I just thought, like, hang on, that's not quite what I wanted to say with this film. So I you know, I believe that if you're being honest in your work as a reporter, which you should be all the time, be honest in the office. So I was being a gobshite in the office. People didn't like it, basically. And people were like, you can't talk to the boss. Because we got a new boss. Like, they moved, got rid of our boss as well. Like, Kevin was the best. And then they moved some other clown in, to be honest, who'd never been to war, recovered it. And he was telling us how to do it. I was like, wow. So it got to the point where they're like, look, we don't really want you here like this. You've got a bad attitude. And it was like, yeah, I have. So they were like, do you want to leave? And I said, yeah, but I want some money to leave, because, you know, I've been to prison, I've risked my life however many times. And they were like, no problem. Gave me a little wedge. It was all right. It wasn't really fair, but it was okay. At the time, I was so skint that I was like, whatever. So I was like, yeah, all right. So I went off, and I still did freelance stuff for them now and then. And I could see it changing. I was doing freelance stuff for other companies. And I was like, you know what? There needs to be, like, war reporting that represents the people again. Like, I feel like Popular Front does that. You know, it shows what the people there are going through, and it makes it interesting for younger people as well, because, you know, young people are not stupid, you know, despite what the media kind of treats them as, and they see bullshit a mile off. So with Popular Front, I was like, right, let me make this really accessible for young people, and then they might learn something as well. Like, oh, it looks cool, it's interesting. Also, I've just learned something without realising it, you know. So I was like, you know what, like, I was getting really jaded with journalism. I was constantly coming up to, like, you know, £100,000 a year, posh as fuck, like, commissioning editors that barely do anything all week, telling me we don't have the budget for this story. Like, how about you take one less chauffeur-driven ride to work a week than we do, you know what I mean? The industry is honestly, I love journalism as, like, what it is, but the industry is disgusting. It's quite bad. It's quite disgusting. But anyway, I got to a point where I was so bitter and jaded. I was like, I'm going to quit. I'm going to go back to labouring. Like, that level of, like, I'm just done. You know what I mean? I had a book deal fall through, and I was like, right, this ain't for me. And I was like, you know what? Don't give up that easy. Just try this one last idea I've got, Popular Front, like, kind of, you know, grassroots war reporting. We don't take investment from anybody corporate, because I've seen how that destroyed, you know, Vice News. Well, not destroyed it, but completely took it off its path that it was on. And I was like, let's just try it. It might work. If it doesn't, that's it. Finished. And within 4 years, I would say it's probably like, what? It's got to be like the biggest grassroots, like, completely independent conflict reporting platform out there, I'd say. You know, like, we're having meetings with, like, very big people now. The irony is, the people that I was meeting as, like, a freelancer and being like, I want to do this story for you, that said no, and now, like, can we work with Popular Front? So I'm like, all right. So it's working, you know what I mean? So that started working, it started making profit. So now I'm like, okay, this is the way forward. And a lot of other people are copying what we're doing, which is kind of odd, but good, like flattering. Some people like taking inspiration from it, which is what I want them to do. I'm like, yes, excellent, that's cool. You do your own thing. And then we've got like the maddest thing, there's this photographer called Boogie, he's known as Boogie. He's like this amazing photographer, he's from Serbia, and I've like my whole like adult life has been into media and stuff like that. I've looked to his work and took inspiration from it. And I had a conversation with him yesterday where he was like, I've just found Popular Front, I want to work with you. I was like, what? Like Boogie, like what, want to work with me? You know what I mean? So that to me is like, that it's going good. You know what I mean? It's going okay. Not to be big headed, but I just think like, it's just like, I was like, what I thought people wanted, I realized like, I'm not that wrong. Like, I'm not that wrong. Like, I kind of hit something that works. And yeah, man, like what we do is, I think we try to show sides of war that no one else is seeing. And we do it in a way where it's a little bit cheeky sometimes, it's a bit irreverent, it's a bit kind of transgressive. But at the same time, the details are way more detailed than anyone else, you know, like, you know, so BBC, like BBC, BBC News does some good stuff, but you know, they might do a 2 minute report. It's like, okay, we'll go there and we'll do a whole hour and then, you know, and we'll make it interesting, we'll make it good and we'll show the reality. We can't be first, but we can be better, I think, you know, so far it's going good. And we're completely grassroots funded. People literally just subscribe to our Patreon for extra stuff. And that's how we do it, you know. And merchandise, believe it or not, like our t-shirts fund documentaries now. Yeah.
Really?
Mad, I don't know how.
Can you remain objective in your filmmaking, considering the subject?
Yeah, that's a great question. I mean, there's this thing, and I've said it 100 times, but if you're reporting on war and conflict and you're seeing children hurt, right, like children shot, which I've seen, you know, you're seeing whole families devastated, you're seeing people lose their land, lose their home, lose their kids, you're seeing, you know, bodies because some government somewhere has decided they don't like this person for whatever reason or whatever. To see all of that and then just go, right, I'm completely objective, I have no opinion on it either way, I'm just saying, I think if you come out of it like that, you're like American Psycho, you've got no feelings, you're sociopathic, you can't see all that and not be affected, you know. So I've always been very upfront with my reporting. You know, I say we're not neutral, we're truthful. We'll say this is what happened here, but I'm not playing some game of like neutrality. There was a good example recently with one of our films where Armenia versus Azerbaijan, there was a big war last year, the year before now, and we made a documentary. And on the news, mainstream news, they were saying there's war crimes on both sides. And that's how they said it, right? War crimes on both sides. Technically, that was true. That's the objective way. Technically, there was war crimes on both sides. But with my doc, we went into what that meant. So what it meant was, I think there's 4 or 5 videos of like Armenians killing prisoners of war. Bad, it's bad, you shouldn't do it, but it happened there. On the other side, you're talking dozens and dozens of videos. To give you an example of how bad Azerbaijan were acting, a video which we included in our documentary, they videoed themselves, soldiers, finding an old man, you're talking about a 60, 70 year old man, beheading him, cutting off his head, killing his pigs, and then balancing his head on his pigs. Like that, to then say there was war crimes on both sides, it's like, hang on, wait, there's a bit more to that, you know what I mean? You're talking about like a country that were giving hero medals to soldiers that had been caught playing football with a 17 year old Armenian Yazidi's head after beheading him. That's not the same as a few Armenian soldiers did some bad stuff and killed some POWs. Very different, you know what I mean? So that's an example I always use. I think to be completely objective, you would just go, yeah, war crimes on both sides, but to really go like, right, hang on, what does that actually mean? It's like, you know, you're talking about, oh, this lad punched someone versus, oh yeah, so then he killed his whole family. Like, no, it's not, you wouldn't then go, they were both violent. You know what I mean? You'd be like, hang on, one's a nutter and one also did whatever. But yeah, so I do think, you know, Popular Front, if you're coming for 100% just dry, straight facts, it's not the place. If you come in for context and nuance and why wars happen and the people involved with them and how it affects them and, you know, how it could affect you if it came here or whatever, then it's the place for that. And I'd argue that the latter is a lot more important as a human being to understand war than, you know, anything else. But some people don't like it, but I say, you know, the kind of dinosaur way of doing journalism is on its way out, you know, like, I want to eat their lunch, you know what I mean? So it's like, you know, I feel like the way we're going, I think it's working.